Okay, hello, anatomy friends. Let us discuss the shoulder muscles, or the muscles that are very closely associated with the shoulder joint. And we're going to start with a posterior view here, which you can see fairly clearly. And let's talk about why we know that this is a posterior view, because we're always trying to get these hints to help us get organized when we're looking at something like this. So for me, few things that really point out that I'm looking at a posterior view. So real quick, I'm going to write that out. Once again, you know my handwriting is better than this in real life, but I'm doing my best here. So you can see a little bit of bone right here that is going to be that scapular spine. If it extends further this way, you're getting towards acromion. So remember that scapular spine is always, always posterior. So a good hint, we're looking posterior. Additionally, over here, I can see your triceps brachii. Triceps brachii is going to be that expanse of three heads in the posterior portion of the arm, and that's always going to be posterior. And since you have that scapular spine and your triceps, you know you're looking at a posterior view. So let's try to tell which muscles we're looking at here, specifically the muscles that are associated with the shoulder region. And this large kind of cap-like muscle is your deltoid, our good friend the deltoid muscle. It is usually pretty easy to tell you're looking at the deltoid. Like I said, I always think of it as kind of the cap of the shoulder. It kind of sits right on top of it. It's going to help form that rounded contour that we're all used to seeing through the skin. It is going to have its proximal attachments on the lateral clavicle, which you can't see here. We'll see in an anterior view the acromion as well as the spine of the scapula, which you can see here. And the osteological landmark that we do want you to know in terms of where it inserts or has its distal attachment is on the deltoid tuberosity of the humerus. And you can see about where that would be located. And that's on that lateral portion of the shaft of the humerus. So the deltoid tuberosity would be right about here-ish. As we have discussed in many, many sessions before, we know the deltoid is going to be innervated by the axillary nerve. Now you can see a little bit how there are kind of separate fibers associated with the deltoid muscle. And this helps form the different parts of the deltoid. You're going to have a clavicular part, which you can't see in this posterior view. Right here would be the acromial portion of the deltoid, and back here in the posterior region would be the spinal portion of the deltoid. These three parts can act independently, and when all three parts act together or contract at the same time, that's really where you're going to get that powerful abduction action that occurs with the deltoid. Okay, now let's see which rotator cuff muscles we can see in this posterior view. And I always go back to that scapular spine because that helps me to get organized in this region. You can see above or superior to the scapular spine is the supraspinatus. So the supraspinatus muscle belly you can see fairly nicely here. It is sitting right within that supraspinous fossa as its proximal attachment, and then it will make its way to the greater tubercle in order to have its distal attachment. And as we discussed, the supraspinatus is going to be the most commonly injured rotator cuff muscle, particularly its tendon, which we've seen in some of the other dissection supplements. Now, underneath or inferior to the scapular spine is going to be the infraspinatus, and it's going to be this kind of larger expanse of muscle underneath here. It is sitting in the infraspinous fossa of the posterior scapula, which you can see here, and it also will have a distal attachment on the greater tubercle. Now, this one is, for me, usually the most difficult one to tell, and that is the teres minor. And as its name would suggest, it is going to be smaller than the teres major. And that is certainly the case, as you can see on this particular specimen. In certain dissections and in certain individuals, It is really difficult to tell the difference between the infraspinatus and the teres minor muscle. We would have to have a nice clear division between the muscles like we do in this particular image for you to know that you're looking at the infraspinus, which will always be superior to the teres minor. And the teres minor will always be superior to the teres major. So to review these muscles that are in this region, this is going to be the infraspinatus. The teres minor is going to be the smallest of these muscles, still a rotator cuff muscle. And then we have the larger teres major right here, which is not a rotator cuff muscle, but a very dominant muscle when you're looking at this posterior view. So it's kind of sitting at this, attaching here at this inferior angle of the scapula, and that's the inferior angle right about here. And it will end up inserting or having its distal attachment on the crest of the lesser tubercle. So not quite on the lesser tubercle like the subscapularis, but on the crest that's a little bit distal to the lesser tubercle. And this is going to be visible or palpable in the posterior axillary region. All right, this is still a posterior view, and you may remember this particular image from when we did the early back dissections before we did the laminectomies. And what I want you to focus on here is the latissimus dorsi muscle, or the latissimus dorsi muscle. It's this expansive muscle. So the majority of the muscle belly is going to be based in a wide attachment in the back region. So it has attachment on spinous processes, the thoracolumbar fascia, if you remember this, the iliac crest, so it goes all the way down into this region. But it's important to note that its distal attachment or its insertion is on the humerus, in the intertubercular sulcus of the humerus. So that means that it crosses the shoulder joint, and therefore it will act on the shoulder joint. So it plays a role in terms of medial rotation, AD or adduction, and extension. So while we think about it oftentimes in regards to the back, because that's where the muscle belly is mostly located, it does cross the shoulder joint, therefore it will act on the shoulder joint. And this isn't on your list of structures, but let's remember our good friend the trapezius over here, because it is going to be very closely related to the shoulder region as well. It inserts or has its distal attachment on the scapula, so it'll play a role in terms of scapular movements. And so really close to the deltoid, which you can see here. All right. One more posterior view here as a review, just because we want to all make sure we're on the same page. Also, in this particular image, you can see the tendons a little better. So, latissimus dorsi, let's start with that one. You can see here is latissimus dorsi here. It is going to be inferior to your teres major muscle. And really, I think it's usually pretty easy to tell the difference between teres major and latissimus dorsi, because you can see latissimus dorsi is going to be more expansive, but you can see how it's heading towards the humerus for its distal attachment. Teres major is this large, robust muscle that is going to be inferior to the teres minor. And this particular specimen has a really nice clear division between the teres minor and the infraspinatus. And a lot of the ligaments and tendinous attachments, because the deltoid muscle has been completely removed in this particular specimen, you can see that scapular spine really nicely, which would be occluded in some areas because of the deltoid if it were there. Now, following the teres minor, you can see its tendon heading over to help form that musculotendinous rotator cuff. Same thing here with the infraspinatus. And then superior to the scapular spine, you have your supraspinatus muscle belly. And you cannot see the tendon quite as well, but it's going to be around this region here, going through the tunnel formed by the coracoacromial arch. And lastly, this is looking at an anterior view. And once again, the deltoid muscle has been removed. It would be kind of sitting right on top of the glenohumeral joint region as well as the acromioclavicular region. And you can see right here, because we've had to kind of laterally rotate this particular specimen in order to see the suprascapular muscle belly, which is going to be located on the anterior portion of the scapula. So sitting right within the subscapular fossa on the anterior scapula, and it will insert on the lesser tubercle, or it'll have a distal attachment on the lesser tubercle, which is right about here-ish, maybe a little bit more inferior. It is the only one, remember, that it's going to have its distal attachment on the lesser tubercle. All the rest of the rotator cuff muscles are going to be on the greater tubercle. And so you can see how its tendon is really helping to reinforce this anterior portion of the joint capsule for the glenohumeral joint region. So if you're looking at an anterior view and you know you're looking at an anterior view for a few reasons, here's your clavicle. Clavicle is always going to be anterior. You can kind of see a little bit of your brachialis muscle right here. You can see your subclavian artery around this region as well, which will transition into the axillary artery. So you know that that's going to be a more anteriorly placed vasculature. So this is an anterior view here. All right, so those are the muscles of the shoulder region. I think that of muscles, like compared to the forearm, this region I think is particularly, or one of the easier ones to be able to identify the difference between the muscles. I think probably the most difficult one is telling the difference between the infraspinatus and the teres minor and the infraspinatus. Just remember, infraspinatus is going to be the larger one. It's going to be directly underneath the scapular spine. Teres minor will be inferior to the infraspinatus and smaller, and certainly smaller than the teres major. And we would have to have a nice division between the muscle fibers in order for you to be able to identify the posterior muscles of the shoulder region. All right, thank you for your attention. I hope this has helped in terms of being able to identify the muscles in the shoulder region. As always, please feel free to reach out to me and any of my anatomy colleagues. We love to talk shoulder muscles. Please have a great rest of your day.